And now let me show you guys a new trick I learned last night.
What?
Johnny, 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 whoop, Johnny, whoop, Johnny, 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 Johnny.
You're serious? You just learned that? You just learned that? I learned that when I was like freaking 10. What took you so long? You were just learning about the Johnny whoop? Dude!
Quote of the day.
That's the cold open. That's the cold open for the podcast. Perfect. Wait for that moment to come. Perfect. Right in the dime.
There can be only one.
I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass. I'm all out of bubblegum.
Go ahead. Make my day.
Cinema Royale.
Hello, welcome to Cinema Royale, where we chew bubblegum and talk about movies. I'm your host, Mike Mixtape, and along with me are my two film aficionados here. My two bestest best of friends a podcaster can ever had. First up, I got Adamat, also known as Matt Brunet.
Hello, everybody! How are we all doing today? Man, I really gotta fix that chair. It's way too squeaky.
And last but not least, James Sullivan, also known as Hi My Dude.
Tonight's broadcast is brought to you by... Do you like bubbles?
Yes, this will be explained later in the podcast.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, boy. This is going to be a fun episode, guys. I can tell, all right?
Yeah.
This episode is all about Christopher Lloyd. But first, a word from our sponsor. This podcast is brought to you by Porn the Game, where everybody gets fucked.
What?
It's a real thing.
Does that exist?
It's a real thing. It's a card game called Porn the Game. The makers and the producers of this game sent me a free copy of this game to play. I don't know who with, but... You can get your own copy of Porn the Game at www.pornthegame.com.
That's your sponsor? That's the legit sponsor you got? I was honestly... Okay, I honestly did not expect that. Okay, for those of you at home, Mike told me that they're like... Okay, before we start things out, like, I need to mention the sponsor. Oh, okay, cool. Like, we talked a bit about, like, sponsors and stuff like that. Then you come out of nowhere with freaking Porn the Game. Is it a game you need to play with friends or like?
Yes, indeed. This is a game. This is a party game for all your adult friends out there. This is the new Cards Against Humanity. Think of it. The way people are describing this game is called the Dirty Uno. The object of the game is to get rid of your cards as fast as possible, and you have to follow what's on the cards.
Do you do what the card says?
Let's see, for example, in the deck, we have... Masturbate. You shuffle a card back in the deck. Hardcore. Each player keeps only two cards, the rest goes back in the deck. Anyone with one card left is out of the game. Let's see, what else? You got a ball gag, you select a player, and that person will have to be quiet.
Okay.
So it's
a sexual Uno.
Yes.
Okay, good. I thought it's like the kind of game where it's like truth or dare, you know?
And honestly, it's been reported or shown porn stars actually playing this quite literally. Like, they take a card, and they're like, hey, let's do this. And they show it on screen. It's like, what the fuck? This is not what the game is. You're not playing the game right, you fuckers.
Technically, they are. I mean, keep in mind, Mike, it's Porn the Game.
Well, it's the guys who made it are really good. I mean,
And are you really going to complain that porn stars are doing their thing?
I mean,
by playing point the game. I mean, they're doing
too literal.
They're doing stuff that should please you, that should arouse you, and you're just there going, you're not playing the game right.
Yeah, so go to www.pornthegame.com and buy it now for only $19.99.
If you want to have go and buy it.
I'll pass.
Awkward sponsor of the day. Sorry about that. I just wanted to see how you guys reacted
to that. Are you also getting money for this? Just wondering. So you're just getting
a card. Is Debbie getting money for this?
Just free promotion. Free promotion for a free copy.
Well, I ain't really gonna get... Well, like, if I buy it for Debbie, then, like, that means I would lose money. Because I spend $20 on a freaking porn the game.
I mean, come on, Debbie will like it. I mean, you guys can play it, and, you know, you can actually do a little roleplay with it, maybe. I don't know. What's
can you open... Can open our opportunity to do that Yu-Gi-Oh! 4 play that we're planning.
Anyways, if you thought this was awkward, it's gonna get more awkward later in the episode. Anyways, let's talk about Christopher Lloyd. Christopher Lloyd is a great actor.
This is about Christopher Lloyd. I forgot.
Did he do porn? I forget.
I had to loosely tie that in somehow. I don't know how I do that. Kooky episode. Oh, yeah, okay. Christopher Lloyd. You may know him as Doc Brown from Back to the Future, as well as many more roles that we're going to talk about here. Let's start out with a classic. Actually, most of these are all classics for all of us. But it's from James' point of view of Addams Family.
Mm-hmm. Ah, so we're starting with me, okay? Yep. Well, let's see. I haven't seen... I'm going to be honest. I picked a few. I sort of cherry-picked both of those films. I haven't seen both of them in a very long time, but it's one of those cases where even if you haven't seen the movies in years, once you've watched them... Once you watch them, they will stand out in your memory. It's hard to really explain it. I mean, the dynamic of this family is so unforgettable.
Of course.
Yes, the in this film, it seemed like such a perfect choice of casting with both the Addams Family and its sequel, Addams Family Values. You have Christopher Lloyd now pretty much, At a time in his career where he could probably just pick up any good role on a platter, I think. Mm. And here he's for the rest of the cast. You had Raul Julia playing Gomez, and that one chick from The Witches as Morticia, and. And Chris, very young Christina Ricci before she was famous, and this was the role that kicked her into popularity as a child actor.
Right.
Mm. But Christopher Lloyd doing this is a very different take on the character. He plays here the role of Uncle Fester. A character in this particularly insane family, this insane and likable family. That's the crazy thing about it. These people are all crazy, but they love each other so much that you just want to side with them the whole way. With his take on Fester, he's a guy who it seems like he loves being a masochist. I mean,
who in the Addams Family is not a masochist? Be fair.
Oh.
It's either it's like, this is a legit, like, entire S&M family. They're either sadistic or masochistic.
It's, well, there you go. But expanding upon the character, though, he always seemed to be the one. When Gomez and Morticia were deriving pleasure from pain, usually they did it with they did it with other people other than themselves. When the kids played Pugsley and Wednesday, they were torturing each other. Mm-hmm. But when Uncle Fester wants to have fun, he tortures himself. He's the only one in the family who legitimately has it out for his own body. This is a guy, oh my goodness, he's not just putting up funhouse slides, but he also enjoys dragging himself through water tanks at the end of it. He likes to electrocute himself.
Yeah, this is especially the fact that, like, one of his most iconic things is, like, he puts a light bulb in his mouth and it lights up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's, this is a guy who just has it in for torture. Mm-hmm. And it's funny comparing his, Christopher Lloyd's performance here. It was very much, he looked the role and everything. He was still just being Christopher Lloyd in the role of Uncle Fester, which works terrifically because he's got all that energy and that enthusiasm. Then I happened to come across in my later years the TV show. Mm-hmm.
It's based on the TV series from the 60s.
Which is, in turn, based off of the comic book by Charles Addams, whose biography I have on my bookshelf. But, it started out as a... Yeah, he started out developing these characters for the New Yorker, I think it was. Mm-hmm. And if you walked around his apartment, he had Charles Addams, the guy that created the Addams Family. He had medieval torture devices in his apartment. He was the real Uncle Fester. He didn't do anything to himself, but you know
he's a real Addams.
Yes. Yeah. What was just. Think of it this way. What was once a chopping block several hundreds of years ago was now the tea table in his living room. That's the kind of guy he was.
So how does it compare to the original Uncle Fester played by Jackie Coogan, I believe it was? Yeah.
Yeah, I look at the Jackie Coogan Uncle Fester, and I think he seems like he's trying to be Curly Joe.
Years
of the Three Stooges.
Yep, I can see that actually.
So he's it works. per se, it works per se. It definitely does, but it has no inkling of bringing oneself, imprinting oneself on the character. You could, that's why I feel like it's not just me watching Christopher Lloyd in the role as the first version of Uncle Fester. It's looking at most of the times that I can recall, he was portrayed and saying to myself, yeah, this is, he was bringing himself into the role and making it work. Everybody else was trying to be Jackie Coogan, who was trying to be Curly Joe. Mm.
Right.
So, who was trying to be Curly Howard? So, I feel like Lloyd just makes that role what it is. Mm.
You know, if I can be very honest, I've actually yet to see any of the Addams Family movies, like whether it be the 1991 film or Addams Family Values. However, I did watch some of the TV series. When I was a kid, I used to always watch, what was it, the 90s Addams Family TV, the 90s animated series. It's like, welcome to the Addams Family, that one. And then there was also the animated one. I think it was by Hanna-Barbera, if I recall. And I used to watch that. And definitely, just the characters themselves, like how they're portrayed, it's definitely... There's something like... weird. They're this weird but delightful family. Like, you know they're messed up, but they're so likable just in the fact of how they all love each other. Like, rather it be like... Morticia and Gomez, like they all like how much they always love each other, or like the shenanigans, the like Wednesday and Pugsley, like they all get into each other as brother and sister. Then you always get that weird uncle, which is Uncle Fester, and then you get Abigail, the witch, and then you also got like the few other extras like Thing and Lurch and stuff like that. So definitely the characters themselves somehow they have this very strange macabre likability into them that like they just completely stand out, and it's just something about it really works. And I remember as a kid also there's this old arcade machine of the Addams Family. It's pretty much this shock thing. I don't know what it was. I don't know how to describe it. It's like you hold on to it and it's like it electrocutes you, and there's like an easy, medium, and hard mode, and it's pretty much Uncle Fester. And it's like the goal is to keep holding on to it so that you give Uncle Fester as much energy as possible. And I remember it was really fun. Really? It was weird, but it was fun.
So you could enjoy the masochist aspect of the Addams Family for yourself in this arcade machine.
No, literally, pretty much, yes. Literally, it's okay. You know what it is? It's an Uncle Fester simulator. That's what it is.
You like that? Yeah, you like holding onto my joystick?
No, and there's two of them. There's actually two. You hold on to two things, and you can even like bring in a friend. Like one is holding one, and the other is holding the other.
Oh. And you have to shock each other, maybe.
I don't know what it is. It's like you got to hold on tight as much. So like,
he's gotta Google it, people. It's gonna be live here.
Hold on. Where is it? Okay. Oh my God. Yes. Okay. There it is.
I've never watched the Addams Family. I probably did watch the film a long time ago as a kid, but I vaguely remember it. It's been a while since I've seen it, so.
Yeah, it's, here we go. It's, Yeah, hold on a sec. It's coming. And I think that's Christopher Lloyd that they have there. Yeah, it's this thing. Yeah. It's called the new Addams Family Electric Shock Machine. Take a look at it.
Oh my goodness.
I think I've seen that. That scared the crap out of me as a kid. I looked at it, I was like, no, heck with that, I'm out of here.
I was like, get that freaky Frankenstein thing away from me.
Get that thing away from me right now. Oh my
God. And I remember it's like, it plays like some kind of freaky music, and throughout the whole time you just hear it's like Uncle Fester's cackle. It's like, and it builds up and builds up. It's like, you hear.
Oh boy, I only have the first thing that came to my mind looking at this machine right there.
Oh my gosh! All right.
How could it not? How could it not be? He's a friendlier version of Pinhead.
Yeah, I can see the resemblance, actually, even with the ears, funny enough.
Yeah, you can see it now.
Like, all he needs is just the freaking pins.
Yeah.
All right, so that's my movie.
Yeah, speaking of movies based on TV series, I'm going to talk about Star Trek III: The Search for Spock.
Oh.
Yes. Where he was a Klingon.
Christopher Lloyd played a Klingon. And honestly, you don't really hear his name once in the film. And it's a quick thing, and I don't remember the name. All you need to know is he plays a Klingon.
I could find it. Hold on. What was it called again?
Star Trek III: The Search for Spock.
Oh, right.
Which, for some reason, some people hated. Me, I was kind of indifferent towards it.
Because it's an odd number Star Trek movie. Everybody loves the even numbers.
Oh, shush. Shush, shush, shush.
I care for them all pretty much equally.
Yeah. I mean, Star Trek 3, yeah, it leaves off right after Star Trek 2, The Wrath of Khan, which is the greatest Star Trek film of time.
Yeah, Commander Krug.
Yeah, I kind of thought it was Krug.
Yes, Krug.
Yeah, all the Klingons say, my lord, my lord, my lord.
Yeah, my lord.
He's the lord of the Klingons, apparently.
Here's my lord of the Klingons.
So
actually, I take that back. What I said, I have not seen the first Star Trek movie, but go on.
Yeah, I never seen it either. I didn't want to get bored, but I don't know. I just skipped right to two. But anyways, three leaves off after two, and so Spock's dead. Planet, his body's on Genesis, the planet Genesis. And it's continuation of Genesis, you know. Genesis this, Genesis that. Because it's like, oh, the Genesis device is evil. You know, you're used in the wrong hands. And Christopher Lloyd's Klingon. Christopher Lloyd comes by it, you know, discovers the information. Like, I gotta get this Genesis device. And it's way too late because already it's been a planet. You know, the device has been used. He can't use the device. It's been a planet. And so he's a late bloomer in the film. He's like, I don't know what his goal is. I mean, it was pretty pointless because you can't get the Genesis device because it's a planet already and you can't use it again. But his portrayal as a Klingon is, he learned Klingon apparently because he can speak Klingon. He speaks Klingon. I mean, it's all it sounds like is.
Yeah, you spit and everything when you talk.
That's what you do in Klingon. You spit it on, you sound like you have a hairball in your mouth. But I'd probably be offending all the Star Trek fans. They're like, you don't speak Klingon right. Do it right. It's like, no, I don't want to speak Klingon.
Emphasize your hacks.
Well, what are you going to do? Offend, are you going to be offensive to Klingons if you don't, if you don't say it right?
I guess, unless I'm translating something.
I actually remember, I think I read in the Guinness Book of Records or something like that, or like Ripley's, or something like those books, that apparently the most offensive thing you can ever say to a Klingon is, I don't know what it is in Klingon, but it's, your mother has a smooth forehead.
I did hear that, yes, because they have the bumps on the forehead, that's what their Klingons are.
Well, if I meet a Klingon, I'll make sure to watch my P's and Q's.
Because you don't want to mess with them, because they're ruthless. I mean, when you see Lloyd as this Klingon, you know, he's got that menacing tone. His English speaking voice, so, kind of sounds like Doc Brown in a way, and I kind of associate it with like an evil clone kind of way voice, like he's speaking like Doc Brown, you know, the same speaking voice, but he's not menacing. Like a deep throat kind of menacing, like I'll discuss with another character he's portrayed in the past. But his Klingon is spot on. I mean, you hear the Klingon, it's just like, holy crap, that's menacing. Like, plus you don't even know what he says half the time. Unless you see the subtitles. I mean, Klingon is Klingon.
Mm-hmm. And not Klingon is not Klingon.
So, you know, he does kill his own people. I mean, you know, he gets information from one Klingon, he kills that person. If one of his crew messes up, like there's a point where he orders his crewmen to shoot at a ship at the engine so he can have Hodges, survivors of the ship. But no, the guy shoots at the ship, he explodes the ship. He's like, hey, I told you to shoot the engine. And he just shoots him like, all right, you had one shot. You had one job. You had one job and you fucked it up. You don't mess with Christopher Lloyd, because if you don't do your job right, you'd be killed.
Yeah, to be honest, I would have to see this movie again, and now talking about it kind of piques my curiosity.
See, I think the only good thing about this film is Christopher Lloyd as the Klingon, because otherwise it's just all about, you know, wait a minute, Spock's alive? We gotta get Spock's body. And Bones has Spock's inner conscious in his head, you know, and there's this point, the most famous, besides Christopher Lloyd, is he goes in the bar and he's like, I want to get the spaceship ride to Genesis, and he's talking to this creature, alien, he's like, Genesis?
Genesis?
He's like, he had this speech impediment, he's like, Genesis? No, this planet is forbidden. No Genesis, we can't go there. It's just so funny.
It sounds familiar.
If you've seen the Nostalgia Critic's review of Star Trek 3, you might know that. Yeah.
Yeah, it's somewhat of a...
It's
somewhat of a meme.
It is a meme. It's just like... And each time I hear Genesis, I keep thinking of the band Genesis, because it's just like, really, you want Genesis? You really want Genesis? Here, here's their albums. Take it, listen to them. I mean, what else can I say about it? I mean, at the end where he's fighting with Kirk, you know, it's all, you know, jumps and choking, and he's very menacing. He's a really good Klingon, and he... Spoiler alert, he dies at the end where he's slowly falling down into a pit of lava.
Oh, you mean the bad guy dies at the end of the movie?
Yeah. Oops, did I spoil the movie?
Uh-oh.
If you want to check out the Star Trek films, 3, in my opinion, is... I wouldn't... If you watch 2 and you want to see more what happens after that, sure, check it out. But if you want to watch the standalone film...
Oh, okay. Now I remember. Sorry. I just saw the clip. I just saw the clip.
Okay.
Yeah, yes, yes.
Okay. Now I remember.
Yeah, so Star Trek 3 is that one film that people don't seem to like, but I think it's okay. It's not that great. Let's go quack to the future and check out another movie based on a TV series known as DuckTales.
Ooh. Oh, yeah, is that what you're tackling, Matt? The animation guy, of course.
Well, of course. I gotta do at least one animation thing. Yeah. And Christopher Lloyd has appeared in a few, one of which being DuckTales the movie. I remember I did review it.
Yep.
Actually, it's been a year ago since I reviewed it. And from what I, and when I saw the movie, it first of all, I just need to mention that I remember watching the series a while back. It didn't leave as much of an impact, but I remember seeing a few episodes. And with DuckTales the movie, that's pretty much how it feels. It's not really much of a movie, but more like an extended episode, because like it kind of goes through the same formula as they would in a regular episode. Like Scrooge would find a treasure, and like plenty of shenanigans ensue in it. But like they did, but it is pretty good for what it is. Like for a movie that spun off from a TV series, it is pretty good. Like that's the only big flaw with it. The rest is pretty much, it is well paced, it is nicely action packed. Even the animation is actually, it has boosted up a little bit.
DuckTales the movie, Treasure of the Lost Land.
What is interesting to also note is that the genie in there. Hold on, I have my script from the review here, and oh no, he's just called Genie, actually. Yeah, there's a genie named Genie in there, pretty much. And the funny thing is that, like, when you watch the movie, you would expect that he's a ripoff of the genie from Aladdin.
I don't have that much.
But the funny thing is that this was released in 1990, 2 years before Aladdin. So, like, he's pretty much a more, like, he still has, like, he still has charm and likability, but like watching him right now, some would think like he's just an Aladdin ripoff or something like that. But anyways, back onto Christopher Lloyd, he actually plays the villain here.
This is definitely not saying that the show is bad.
Murloc. He's pretty much this old. He's pretty much this old wizard where he wants to get the genie's lamp because a part of it would give him like, because he actually has this medallion. And like once he connects it to the lamp, he would be able to get like unlimited wishes.
Or is it not even worth a look?
And he actually
villain in search for a lamp. Where have I seen that?
The story.
You can't say it rips off Aladdin. I just said it released before Aladdin.
I did. So yeah.
No, but
yes, but even so, Aladdin is a classic story.
Yeah, true.
But I digress.
No, okay, yeah, it's true. But anyways, he really is an interesting villain. Like with the low booming voice that he has, he really does portray a really threatening villain. And I got to say there are a lot of animated bits where he would transform and we literally see the transformation in him. It's actually really amazing. It's actually quite impressive even for an anime, like even for an animated feature,
patient of a
like,
TV
it
series
really
is
looks
no
good.
Easy task.
But
the challenge comes from making
other than
something
that
feels
it,
bigger
like,
than any
it's mostly
other
an extended. It does feel like
with
an extended
DuckTales
episode,
movie,
but considering how DuckTales
is
good, it does make out for
a
pretty
a
decent
effort.
Movie.
The way the
like,
plot works is that it
for someone who has
its way
like,
up
if
to
you,
get
if
the
you like
interest.
DuckTales, like this is most definitely for you. You would love it as much as the series, but other than that,
like
it is a nice little introduction to know how, like, the tempo of DuckTales is. So yeah, it's good. It's good. DuckTales is good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I remember seeing that. That was just one of those movies in my childhood sort of came and went, It was, we saw it in the store one time, walking through, and it was just on one of the TV sets playing. We borrowed it from a friend, and later on I remember watching it while babysitting. So that it's something that you can pop in, I guess, every couple of years to sort of
it's like for those who have seen DuckTales, it's a good nostalgia builder.
I remember watching this, like, I was a huge fan of DuckTales. I am still a huge fan of DuckTales, and I remember seeing the movie, and I used to play that constantly, like, over and over and over. Like, it was one of the top films, along with my Ninja Turtle films. It was just, you know, it was a nostalgia factor for me.
Mm-hmm.
It is. All it is for DuckTales fans is nostalgia. Nostalgia, nostalgia, nostalgia. All it is. And Merlin, the Christopher Lloyd does, you know, he's, like I said before, he's known for his villainous roles, and he does have that booming voice when it comes to, you know, his voice acting. It's, like, very creepy. It kind of reminds me of, he kind of does the same thing when he did the series of Cyber Chase that was on PBS, where he played the villain. But
don't remember that.
It's very obscure for those who don't watch PBS. It ran for a long time, and it's pretty much a PBS math show where it was promoting math for all the situations. But what else can you say about it? I mean, DuckTales the movie is DuckTales. Uh-huh.
Yeah, DuckTales is DuckTales. DuckTales the movie is DuckTales.
It's all you need to know. If you want to see Christopher Lloyd be a badass in a DuckTales movie, go check it out. If you've seen the original series and you love DuckTales, that's the catch.
Yeah.
That's the catch.
Like, that's the one thing I was honestly surprised that it didn't really caught on. Like, Murlock really is a great villain. Like, he's up there with Magica and Glomgold. Like, I'm surprised they didn't bring him back a few times. Not even for the, maybe not for the remake of, DuckTales Remastered. But, I'm surprised they didn't bring, they just didn't bring him back. He really is an interesting character.
Yeah, I was just thinking about that. It's like, yeah, he's canon to the DuckTales.
Mm-hmm.
So it's canon. I don't know why they couldn't. I guess they were sticking to the TV show more than the movie, I guess. I don't know. That would have been actually interesting to play against him in the game. It would have been pretty cool.
Like a bonus level, you know?
Yeah, like a bonus level. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That would have been really good for the DuckTales fans.
Hang on.
Yeah, but technically, yeah. But technically, it was like, while I was saying that, I just realized, it's like, wait a minute, it's like a level-to-level remake. It's like the game is pretty much what you get on NES, except remastered, and you get the voices.
Oh, crap, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah, that's the thing I forgot.
That's right, you forgot to mention that, because it is a remastered.
Yeah, it's like a heart-to-heart. It's like a very
heart-to-heart. Yep, I totally forgot about that. But see, yeah, if it was a bonus, I don't know. It would have been, I mean.
Although the one thing, this might be controversial for me to say, but, like, I kind of do feel sympathetic to like, some of the voice actors in there, like Alan Young and June Foray. Like, they do try to bring, to return as the voice, but you can hear the rust, just saying.
In a way, yes. There was a new Mickey Mouse cartoon with an appearance by Scrooge McDuck.
And Alan,
I noticed that, and everybody's like, oh, Scrooge McDuck is in this cartoon, oh my god, Alan Young's voicing it, sounds so great.
Well, now he just sounds older.
I guess like he sounds appropriate.
Yeah, I was gonna say appropriate because his character is a bit.
Yeah, it's like when Jue Foray grew old. Like when Jue Foray grew old, like she's been voicing Granny for so many years, and now she's the perfect. It's like now she's the perfect age, and like that's pretty. Now she's got the right tone for Granny.
Exactly. Yeah.
And she can just talk, and it comes out like that now.
Exactly. And she's still up and going, and she's almost a freaking 100. Maybe surpassed 100.
But yeah, if you want to see Christopher Lloyd being evil, of course, and you like DuckTales, you gotta check out DuckTales the movie, Treasure of the Lost Lamp. And if you don't want to watch the whole movie, just check out Animat's review. It's actually almost been a year since he released the review, on YouTube, at least.
Yeah. I just thought it was pure coincidence, actually.
So, going from... Wait, I'm trying to think here. Is
James' turn, I think.
It is James'
turn. I started off, I know, then it was you, Mike, then it was Matt, now...
Don't criticize me. I'm just thinking of... Dennis the Menace was a cartoon, and it was originally a comic strip, so I was just saying, this is another... movie based on a TV series / comic, which I see a theme going around with all these films, which is weird. But yeah, James, he has Dennis the Menace.
Yes.
He was in Dennis the Menace?
Yes.
Oh my God,
yes.
He was, how shall I put this? An entertaining yet somewhat last-minute introduced villain.
Yes, that is right, yeah.
The whole principle of Dennis the Menace kind of fascinated me. I grew up mainly in the early 90s, I watched reruns of the old sitcom, the black and white sitcom on Nickelodeon. But I always found it sort of passable, and I didn't really get into it. The mid-80s cartoon, that to me was something palatable, something catchy, something I would always watch, and it was rather memorable. And I always enjoyed the character of Dennis and how he manages to be this somewhat troublesome character, while at the same time sort of just being a kid who has a reputation.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have the John Hughes film from the early 90s. And something different happens here. Something definitely different. Not bad, but I will say... the spin that this movie puts on the formula of Dennis is that Dennis himself is not an intentionally menacing character. He's not everything that he does in the movie is something that he's trying to do to help somebody out, and the trouble comes from the fact that he goofs it up and somebody else gets hurt. So, the irony being, in the end of the film, Dennis is chewed out by Mr. Wilson, who's just, how can I say this? Walter Matthau, he's a grumpy old man.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Perfect for the role of Mr. Wilson.
Yeah.
So
he looks like Mr. Wilson.
I didn't know so much about him looking like the role of Mr. Wilson, but he had
the grumpiness.
He had the grumpiness. He had that factor nailed to the floor.
Hey, Mr. Wilson.
Yeah.
So the irony is, Dennis has this quirk about himself where he's accidentally causing trouble for people. So he runs away. Bit of a spoiler. At the end of the movie, he runs away.
Mm-hmm.
And it causes everyone to go out looking for him. And Mr. Wilson is on a guilt trip because he's the one that chewed him out.
Yep.
And where does he end up with? Well, he ends up with Christopher Lloyd.
Yeah.
Yep.
I know this film pretty well. I've seen it as a kid. Christopher Lloyd plays
this... You wouldn't know him, the name of his character, because it's not mentioned. I remember reading it off of the back of a magazine that was advertising for the Super Nintendo game. Switchblade Sam is the character.
What? That's his name?
That's his name.
What?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, it is right here on the IMDb.
Yeah, Switchblade Sam.
Hey, town robber. Yep. Holy shit. That's...
Yep.
I never heard of that name. I was just like, I just
know him as a thief. Yeah, me neither.
I just knew him as a thief.
Yeah, he's a bad guy.
He's a baddie. He's a gruesome twosome.
Mm.
Here was where the John Hughes formula started to show, though.
Yeah.
At the same time, he was starting to move away from the stuff that he was doing, the stuff that he was producing in the 80s, like teen dramas,
mm-hmm.
and whatnot.
Right.
And making more. And once Home Alone happened, it was a whole different ballgame.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. He started making movies like that. So that's why... That's partly why I think this movie was made, was because they could further the formula of using slapstick comedy.
Mm-hmm.
And Christopher Lloyd gets his ass kicked.
Oh, yeah. Yep.
In this movie.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, it's glorious too. Oh my God,
this is almost mean spirited. I mean, he gets.
It's all accidental. I mean, it's not like just does it on purpose. It just, you know, Dennis does something, and all of a sudden, you know, the precautions of what he did happen to Christopher Lloyd, or Switchblade Sam.
Well, I always notice that the things that happen to him here, if he could have switched roles with Harry or Marv, he would have been much better off. This guy, what was it? He gets a rope tied around his waist.
Yep.
And I still remember this. He gets pulled up to the ceiling with this rope tied around his waist, practically capsized by it. It's a train pulling him up there.
Yeah.
Oh god.
I mean, you're surprised his body doesn't fold in half and just go and he's dead. But he, you know, the rope breaks, he falls flat He falls flat on his face, and then his switchblade comes down between the legs.
Yep. That's...
And I knew as a kid watching it right where it hit. That, wow.
No more switchblade babies.
I just grew up with this. I mean, this is another film.
The implications of what just happened there. Oh my god.
I mean, oh my god, that's my childhood, man. I mean, that's the film I grew up on. I mean, I had a clamshell, you know, big box of VHS of Dennis the Menace. And I used to watch it too all the time.
And he has the just the best look on his face after that.
Oh yeah, like, he's good with facial expressions.
Yeah.
So, do you remember that there's a scene where he was walking along an alley and he sees a boy eating an apple, takes a twitch blade, uh-huh. and he gets the apple? There's mm-hmm. a quote here by Christopher Lloyd talking about that scene. I had a scene in that when I'm walking along an alley and I see a boy eating an apple, I reach over the fence with a big knife and I snare the apple, and I ate the apple. And the boy playing that role must have been 6 or 7 years old. He was horrified of me. Even when I was out of makeup, he hid behind his mother when he saw me, just walking as myself, just absolutely terrified.
Oh. Oh.
So his
could have been worse. He could have said that he could have done his Judge Doom bit.
Oh, man, that would. But yeah, so. If you are intrigued by that, like, you want to see what he looks like in the film, you gotta watch Dennis the Menace.
Mm-hmm.
It's
yeah. It's, I remember, I just need to have my input in this. I remember watching it a while back when researching for the top 10 worst films based on a cartoon, and I decided to put in Dennis the Menace. And I gotta say, my god, this has to be the most cheesiest 90s film I have ever yep. seen, but mm-hmm. For some reason, it's just glorious cheese.
It is.
It's like it has all those, it has all the cliches and like all the tropes that they do that you would expect in a 90s film, but it's just like, it's like, you know why they're tropes. You know why they're just so fun to watch. And it's just, you know, it's like, it really does have a charm. It's not the most original. It's not the greatest film, but it definitely has a charm. And I just really like it.
Mm-hmm. And also, another thing to note about this film is that this is the reunion of Leah Thompson and Christopher Lloyd, who had previously been in Back to the Future together.
Oh, yeah. Oh, and also, I forgot, there really is a nice charm. There really is a lot of heart in this movie. Like, the relationship with Mr. Wilson and Dennis, like, there's a lot of heartwarming moments.
Yeah.
I gotta say.
Mm-hmm. And it's... Yeah, it's... It's a perfect example of a rather difficult friendship.
Yeah.
That these two characters have.
Mm-hmm. I did forget to mention that with Lloyd has quoted saying that his favorite role ever portrayed in his acting career was in Star Trek III, The Search of Spock, playing Commander Kirk
Klingon. Well, I mean, he is a Klingon. Well, I mean, he gets to be a Klingon, so...
Because he was a fan of the original Star Trek, so I just wanted to mention
that. Oh, okay.
Just,
that makes sense.
I forgot to mention that.
I get to be in part of Star Trek! That's why I love it!
Great Scott! I love it. Yeah, mm-hmm. God. Good childhood movies. DuckTales and Dennis the Menace. God. Fucking love it. Nostalgia trip.
Christopher Lloyd is 90s.
I was saying Christopher Lloyd for me is a major nostalgia trip because it's just like he's the actor I grew up with.
Yeah.
He's been.
Oh yeah.
He's like.
Whether you love him or hate him, well, love him or love to hate him, actually.
Yeah.
You can't hate on Christopher Lloyd.
No, no. Depending on what role he does. It's not next.
We'll get to that later.
We'll get to that after me.
No, we're saving that for last.
It is. It is last. It's just me. Mm-hmm. I'm next, and then we go to the best part of the podcast, all right? So I just want to kind of introduce this, because this is kind of a new thing for everybody watching, because this is something that not everybody knows. A select few people know. A select group, you know, a good cult fan going. Group cult. There's a show. All right, so... I've been breaking rules on this podcast since day one. I've talked about TV shows. We talked about video games relating to the topics. You know, it's not just Cinema Royale. It's just like, it's just the Royale of topics, pretty much. So I figure I talk about a role that Christopher Lloyd has played in a TV show. It was a guest star role, and he guest starred in a pilot episode of a mid-80s TV show that got canceled. You know, so it's a short-lived TV series, but it's a Knight Rider. It's kind of like a Knight Rider clone, but it's not. Mm-hmm. It's a show where it's basically
a Knight Rider-esque kind of TV series.
It's kind of like it's got the super vehicle aspect. It's like it's a super vehicle. We got this super duper vehicle, and we get to use it to fight crime. And the show is called Street Hawk. It's the pilot episode sets up of a guy named Jesse Mock. He's a motorcycle cop, and then all of a sudden he and his friend Marty gets into some trouble. They bump into
Marty. What? Marty's in trouble.
I have a super vehicle right here, we can save him.
There you go.
Mind you, this came out in 1985, the same year as Back to the Future, but a few months before it came out. 30 years ago, to be exact. 30 years ago. Okay, totally forgot that connection. Marty. Fuck. Mm-hmm. Got me there. Got me good. So,
if you don't give me the cocaine shipment by next Friday, you're gonna see some serious shit.
That is good. That is clever.
So, as James quoted, he is a coke dealer. Christopher Lloyd plays a coke dealer, and I guess Marty and Jesse, you know, they have like a little dirt bike race, and Marty's in the lead. He takes a head start, and Marty discovers, you know, Christopher Lloyd's sting operation with, you know, whatever's going on. So, Christopher Lloyd kills Marty. Oh my God. And Jesse Mock, you know, he discovers that, and then, you know, he gets ran over by Christopher Lloyd's, big black truck, and he gets injured in the process. So his knee is all bad, so he can't be a motorcycle cop anymore. He works in PR now, and he has to solve his best friend's murder.
Life's a bitch.
Life's a bitch for Jesse Mock, and until a guy named Norman Tuttle comes in with this project of his. You know, he wants a rider for his all-terrain super vehicle, you know, known as Street Hog, this all-terrain motorcycle. And, you know, he gets this knee surgery in the process. He works on getting it better, and it becomes the rider of Street Hawk, this amazing, awesome bike that shoots lasers and jumps up in the air like 30 feet in the air and all that stuff. So Jesse's main focus in the episode is to find who killed Marty and try to get revenge on Marty and himself, you know, with Christopher Lloyd's character named Anthony. So, like I said, he guest stars in the episode. He's not in it a lot. You get glimpses of it, but there's actually one scene. Like, I swear, it's by the pool. He's by the pool, and he talks to the police commissioner. You know, oh my God. Oh, twist. The commissioner was in all of it. So, but yeah, he's by the pool, and there's this one part where this hot chick, this young hot one hot chick comes up to him. He's like, baby, I'm not feeling so good. Can I have some medicine?
Yes. And then Christopher Lloyd just rejects her completely. He's like, out of my way. I need to do business.
Out of my way. I gotta do business. You, kill Mock. But see, that's like, you know, he's a badass. You know, he's got the chicks, you know, he's giving medicine to the chicks.
Yeah.
And this is such a different role for Christopher Lloyd.
Me, Mike, and James, we all did this running gag where pretty much the most evil thing Christopher Lloyd has ever done is not give the girl her medicine.
Yeah, her medicine. Close. Mm-hmm. You know, I was thinking like, Matt, you said
the pill has to wait, baby.
If you got the reference to medicine, then you have a dirty mind like me.
What the fuck have you done?
Anyways. Like I said, it's a pilot episode for another character. You know, Christopher Lloyd's the bad guy. And yes, of course, the bad guy dies at the end.
Wait, I need to reenact this. I have to reenact this. It was a moment when Christopher Lloyd got a taste of his own medicine.
Yep.
So, what I meant earlier by his voice, you know, his voice is key when it comes to these villainous roles. Like, you know, in DuckTales, he has this big booming voice. You know, in Star Trek 3, he doesn't have this, it's not a booming, but it's like a regular speaking voice when he speaks in English, but he speaks in Klingon, it's totally different. This, however, in this role, he's got this raspy, deep voice. Like, it's very raspy. Like, more than usual. Like, it's not like deep, but it's just like it's something different than he's ever done that I've noticed. Like, he doesn't have that voice when it comes to other roles. And honestly, I mean, it's kind of cool how this little show that was trying to make it big and eventually got canceled got Christopher Lloyd to be in as a guest star. And yes, I got these guys actually watch it with me because I just wanted to show them a little show that I like. I mean,
it was pretty good. I'm not gonna lie.
Yeah, I could see
it was a good show.
I could see the appeal of it, even though most of the part, like everything, like most of the part, it's pretty much your generic cop show, you know. It's like it's the generic cop show where like you got every single trope from like the nerdy sidekick that's more responsible and stuff like that. You got the betraying cop, and then you got the love interest and all that kind of stuff. But the main appeal is mostly because of this super motorbike that like, and I could see where like everybody who loves motorcycles, like they would love this show because it's pretty much.
Yep, like
what happens if you take Kip from Knight Rider, you make him shut up and you get like you turn him into a motorcycle. That's pretty much what it is.
Mm-hmm. Basically, yeah, it's a souped up motorcycle. And you know, those fans out there, you know, they in real life they probably just rode on their bikes, you know, and they kinda hum the theme song in their head like na 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 na. You know, they're so much fun being a fan of Street Hawk at that age, you know. And and I even told Matt this during the screening was it's kinda different between every country. Like the American pilot has a red laser for the bike. And apparently in Canada, I don't know why, but there was a Canadian pilot of the show, and it had a blue light, like a blue laser, which is like, why? I mean, I guess they were testing something out with the Canadians. I don't know. Just I thought it was really different, and I
kind of. I have no idea.
I know. I should actually just send him the copy of the original and show him, but I just thought it was.
No, Mike. You should You should have sent the red one to James and send the blue one to me.
That's what I. You know what? Because. Do I have it with me? No. I have it on DVD, and I could have done that, because it's on... But it's like, oh, it's on YouTube, and it's like, fuck, here it is. It's convenient, but that's what I originally wanted to do. I actually wanted to show James the U.S. and you the Canadian version. I didn't say nothing, and he'd be like, hey, what's this? Because they're the same thing, but it's just different color laser.
Or, like, I could imagine, like, you would be trolling me. But I was like, well, I was like, oh, check out those red lasers. It's like,
that was blue.
Exactly. That would have been a perfect payoff. I don't know. It's different because the Canadian one has, like, you know, the crop, and it's got the numbers on the bottom, like it's unreleased kind of thing.
Oh, yeah. Like the counting numbers, yep. Like take one. That kind. I've seen that before.
Yeah, that was... But, yeah, Christopher Lloyd, you know, he plays a baddie. I mean, he's done a lot of villainous roles, and, you know, you could chalk that up to, you know, oh, that's another villain role, out of the way. I mean, he does threaten the police commissioner at one point with a screwdriver where, if you don't do my shipment, I'll turn your car into a pretty kebab.
I'm gonna keep on scraping this pretty little car, and then I'm gonna go and scrape your pretty little head. No, your pretty little face. You understand? All right. Otherwise... Now go and kill Mark.
Otherwise,
as the most threatening car keying villain ever.
It's a one note ish villain, and
because he gave that car some bad medicine.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, yes, if you want to see another villainous role by Christopher Lloyd in a underrated TV show, check out Straight Hawk. I mean, if you watch the first episode, check out the second episode. It's got George Clooney in it. It's got George Clooney in it, guys. If you want to see young George Clooney, check out Straight Hawk.
That I didn't know.
I already did, Attack of the Killer Tomatoes 2.
Oh.
It's one of his...
I skipped over Grizzly 2, don't worry.
You know, I thought about a worse, like, medicine joke. One more medicine joke, but that one is a little bit worse. It has to do with the last one I did. But I don't think it's even worse.
See, everybody? Matt has a dirty mind. He's got this dirty mind going.
But I have limits.
Yeah.
Limits. Where else would I be able to dish out my dirty mind?
I know. This is the perfect thing for you, because you could be squeaky clean Adam, Matt, and you could be Matt Brunet, the dirty mind in man.
That's why his hair is like a mop.
And then there's Matt Brunet.
Because he'll play Porn, the game, with you.
Wait, what?
Hey, ladies, he's single out there. He can play Porn, the game, with you.
That's true.
Just take the deck of cards and go through and be like, oh, hey, you want a hand job? Here you go.
Were you implying that I would ask to the ladies that? Well, technically, they have their version of a hand job.
So awkward. So awkward.
It ain't really awkward.
Don't mind me, officers. I don't know these two.
Boy.
What do you mean, officers? This ain't illegal.
Okay, this is the big event we've all been waiting for. This is the big kahuna of the podcast.
Yes, ladies and gentlemen.
I don't... Ladies and gentlemen, let me do a little backstory.
No, I want to do it. It's my movie. I get to do it. Fine. Okay?
Fine, you do it then.
It's my movie.
Alright.
Now, for some reason, I decided to go and review this movie. And, like, I wanted to watch this movie because I was highly curious and I was highly stupid. The movie that I'm referring to was a 2012 feature film that nowadays people are considering it one of the worst films ever made out there. And somehow it has Christopher Lloyd doing these weird movements and stuff like that. But not just that, there are a few other well-known names in there, and that's surprising. It has scarred and traumatized everyone, a lot of people that have seen it. And of course, it is coming from me. I am referring to Oogieloves. And by the way, people, no, I am not insane enough to go and watch Food Fight yet. Just saying. Let me start off by saying the plot of Oogieloves. Oogieloves is the story of these three weird turtle things. And they're celebrating they want to, like, organize a surprise party for their pillow. Don't ask why. But apparently their guardian, a talking vacuum named J. Edgar, yeah, get the stupid pun, he did something stupid and he lost all the balloons. So now the Oogieloves has to go to each individual place to meet someone, like, they gotta go talk to someone, waste so much time doing a stupid song and dance routine, and then go and get the balloon. Along with audience interaction to get up and dance, and sing-alongs, and all that kind of stuff. And yeah, this is literally one of the weirdest and stupidest films I have ever seen. And I have seen some bad, stupid ones. This is literally Oogieloves. I would probably put it on the same level as Escape from Tomorrow. It is just that weird. Oh my god, where do I even begin? First of all, it's highly repetitive as hell. Because it sets itself up like a freaking video game. Where, like, it's so formulaic. They look for a They go to a place to find the balloon. They meet the weird and wacky person there. They have a musical number. And then they realize, okay, let's go get the balloon. And then they do their little dances like, hey, 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 shiny, shiny, Oogieloves, 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 and all that. Like, it's so formulaic and repetitive. And, like, it's just, it sets itself up as a children's TV show. Like, this is supposed to be, like, apparently this is from someone that also worked on Thomas the Tank Engine and Teletubbies, if I recall, I think. And, he pretty much decided to take a children's TV show and extend it to this 80 to 90 minute feature. Wow, and oh my god. Like, first of all, like, when you enter in, like, you get thrown in these weird things from a freaky, like, this really freaky window lady. Mm-hmm. And then you get, like, the whole goal of the movie is just way messed up. They have to go and find balloons that when they see one, it suddenly talks, all for this pillow. This comatose freaking pillow. And, like, the people in there, a lot of them, it feels like they lost their pride and dignity. Because you also get some well-known people in there, like Cloris Leachman. Like, you got Cloris Leachman as this, like, circle-obsessed woman with probably the best thing about this movie is that I think it's like her granddaughter or her daughter or something like that. It's this girl who's obsessed with squares. The best thing about this movie is that that girl is actually kind of hot. And mm-hmm. Then you go to this milkshake place to you get this milkshake place where, like, you get this cool daddy-o milkshake Marvin going down, you know, swinging around. You got a matcha move for your milkshakes. Ooh, that's my favorite. And then, let's see, the next one. What's the one afterwards? The third one, if I recall, yeah, is this really egotistical rose lady where she has a bit, like, she's allergic, but she only has tiny sniffles. Like, she's a bit allergic to roses, but she's so obsessed with them. But that's not freaking allergies. And then you get, oh my god, one of my favorites. You get this bubble. Yeah, this is what James did at the beginning. Bobby Wobbly. This guy is so obsessed with bubbles, but you can see in his face he lost that he sold off his pride, his dignity, his soul, his will to live, all at the same time. Like, he lost it all. And, like, you really feel sympathy for this actor. And then comes Christopher Lloyd, where he's like this like, I got a feeling he's like this sugar daddy to this crazy Spanish chick. And he, like, he can only communicate through bongos, and sometimes he talks. Oh, and did I forget to mention he lives in a flying sombrero?
There, Lero Sombrero is his name.
Yeah. That's his name, Lero Sombrero?
Yes.
Okay, and I gotta mention, guys, do you remember when I watched, when we watched That's My Boy? I broke down, yep. Like, in a really sad manner.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I broke down in this movie as well, except this time I went insane. I literally went crazy. Like, I was participating. I was singing whatever going at the end of the movie. And I actually made this, and I made up with this crazy allegory that, apparently, this movie is a retelling of the Three Wise Kings, where they all have to go and get presents for Jesus Christ, which is the talking pillow. And then we have, I think, the freaky window lady is God, or I think is Saint Gabriel or something. And that's what this whole movie is. And I literally went crazy. And just to let you know, I have it all on tape. I'm uploading it on YouTube. You'll see it soon on my channel. And, like, this is why I refuse. I said no to join you guys. Like, I went insane. I literally had to go to the bathroom and throw water to my face. Like, I had to pour water on my head several times to calm myself down.
Okay.
Oh my god. Now I need to know, how did you guys enjoy Oogieloves?
Okay, let me just let me just talk about this.
And keep in mind, they asked me to go and watch Oogieloves with them on the same day that I saw it. I had to refuse because like I cannot survive watching Oogieloves twice on the same freaking day.
Let me clarify something. We had this screen planned for a while. I told them, straight away, let's watch this together. No man should watch this alone. And what does he do? He watches the damn movie early in the day. You know, he could have just watched it with his peers, you know, as a support group. But no, he has to go freaking insane by himself.
I'd like to add a little bit to that, because I think there's some blame on my part. When I sent this movie out to everybody, I codenamed it Technicolor Nick Jr. Nightmare, and that's, I think, where Matt got a little bit confused because he didn't know what it was.
Right. Yeah.
Yep. Right, because, yeah, if you did it the right way.
Like, most of it is because of my stupidity. I'll take most of the blame for it.
He's got some things, but okay. So, yeah, like I said, we watched Street Hawk together, and afterwards, Matt left, and it was up to James and I to watch Oogieloves. James at first said, hey, my lights are out, I'm gonna go to, this is like a sleeper for me, I'm gonna fall asleep, if I snore, don't worry about it. I'm like, okay, alright, sure.
Bull crap, I've called bull crap.
Just wait, let me, and what he did, he stayed up through the whole film. He did not fall asleep whatsoever. I'm like, dude, you said you're gonna fall asleep. It's so colorful and bright. I couldn't fall asleep.
I don't know what it is. You know, I used to turn on all kinds of crap on Netflix and just have it play on my laptop while I snooze off at night. But no, this past week has been a little bit different. And with this film, yeah, I was awake for the whole thing. And here's my, you're gonna be very surprised at what I have to say.
Come on, James.
It's okay. One. I remember back when this was getting released, and it was the talk of the town amongst everyone who was wanting to hate it. Hate it. People were Skyping it in my direction saying, good God, look at this, etc. Everyone was reviewing it, making fun of it, and I wouldn't give it the time of day. So I, watching it, sitting down and actually watching this, going into it, I was thinking to myself, remember, I am not the, we are not the audience for this.
Exactly.
We're not the target demographic.
We're not the target demographic.
Right.
So that's what one thing that you're going to have to consider. Yep. When watching it. And the other thing is, I actually think it was technically not a bad movie, considering
what?
That it was released. What? Considering that it was released for children of the ages of 5 through 7, because
no, that is
it
not,
was just
5 through 7. Are you freaking kidding me?
Or younger. Okay. The problem is, they should never have released this in theaters. It should never have been released in theaters. It should have gone direct to television. It should have gone direct to video. Anywhere but the theater. Because no one wants their kids getting up and dancing in the theater. There's not even enough room.
Exactly. I mentioned that.
That's exactly what I thought. Because, like, okay, now a kid's movie, in a sense, like, what it's supposed to do is, like, your parents should, like, the parents should pop it up on TV, and it keeps their kids, like, calm and quiet for, like, an hour and a half while the parents do their other stuff. This one, it tells their kids to make noises, to shout things out, to dance along, to go crazy. It's like, that kind of defeats the purpose of a kid's movie, you know? It makes no sense.
It's encouraging them to do all the things that you're not supposed to do while watching a movie. I know that. But here's the thing. I've mentioned this before to you guys, probably on this podcast. I work in the school system. I work with students of all ages, mostly students who are mentally handicapped. And there have been situations where we just sort of sit the kids down and have them watch something, and it'll be something in the vein of Dora the Explorer or Super Y. And there's a level of interactivity that is always executed in children's television And that's just what they're doing here. It's Teletubbies all over again. That's why I think we're not the target demographic. It was just not the way to be released. But as for my personal enjoyment of the film, my God, there are some flaws that I think need to be addressed here.
Some?
Yes.
You could just say the movie, and that can explain everything.
Obviously, the formula is too vague here. They've constructed a very loose plot to go out and search for birthday balloons, which I actually thought were kind of creepy.
That's the creepy part for you, the balloons?
Yes, the Carl's Jr. smiley faces on them.
We're magical balloons.
Yeah. Me, it's the window. Me, it's the freaking window.
Are you serious? Come on.
Like, how the, like, you see these, like, weird faces, like, and then suddenly you get this realistic face on the freaking window.
Hi, y'all, I'm Wendy Window. I got a southern accent.
She's like the it's like the master of the house. It's like they're doing all these things to please her. I don't know. I get these Madame Liuta from the Haunted Mansion vibes from that woman.
Wow.
Don't you think? I don't know. Maybe it's just me.
I know it's a trend where every time you see Wendy Window, she has a different drape style, like a hairstyle. Like, it's not the same one. And it's like,
I think this is the thing. I think, like, the vacuum, like, that's a way to calm his stress. Like, to do all these different things to her curtains.
That could be. Oh, of course.
Could be like a stress reliever.
I think he was flirting with her in the beginning.
Yes, Jay.
That's what I was,
he blushed and everything.
Yeah, Jay
and
Edgar has a huge crush on Wendy Window. I mean, how does a vacuum in a window...
Yeah, no, that's what I was thinking. It's like, are they like the parents to these Oogieloves? Like, when a window with a face and a vacuum mate, do they make these weird turtle things? Like, what are Oogieloves?
No. They give birth to the brave little toaster. That's what happens.
That's something like that. Yeah, yeah.
That works.
Yeah.
So... But what I was trying to say is that for something that is just a loose plot built around an excuse to get kids to get up and dance, you can't help but see it from the formula that it is. It's just that. And as for the music, my goodness.
Yes.
That's where I'm gonna say.
Oh yes.
What did they? We were talking. Me and Mike said, I was just like, I'm pretty sure that they wrote this music in a day. He's like, and Mike was like, no, they wrote it while sitting on the toilet before going into the pitch room.
That's what I said.
Yeah,
just on a piece of toilet paper.
Yeah, like do some kind of last minute revision before the exam. Like, they just do
just
everything.
We roll toilet paper.
Oh my God, yes.
Here.
These songs are literally some of the worst I've ever heard in a movie. I kid you not when I say that I felt I actually missed Party Time when hearing these songs.
See, they it's not so bad. I've been telling people that for years.
It's just literally...
the wrong movie.
Oh my God, like, Party Time was stupid. The soundtrack takes it to a whole new freaking level. I mean, holy jeez. Like, I've heard, like, even How Bad Can I Be from The Lorax was more tolerable than this. Oh, my Lord. Like, I had to make commentaries and riff on whatever I'm seeing. Like, just because, like, it drains out the music. Like, I had to. Because I had to do it not just because, like, I want to be funny, but also because I don't want to listen to this freaking music. Even if what I say is not funny, it'll be better than, like, what I'm freaking listening to.
Yeah, you can tell from the get-go when they have the theme song coming up and they're just like, we're the Oogieloves, Oogieloves.
Yeah, that's the opening song, Oogieloves. We're the Oogieloves. That's kind of parody, like a parody of, or a remake of We're the Monkeys.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. No, you know the worst thing? The intro. I cannot believe this. You guys realize the intro is the tutorial for the movie?
Well, don't die, you think? Hey, kids, you see this below, that means you get up.
You see the butterflies, that's when you get up and dance. When you see the turtles, that's when you sit down. Oh, my God. Oh, that's another thing. Because of the terrible musical numbers, I have never felt so happy to see turtles in a movie ever since Finding Nemo. I swear to God, when those turtles come in, I was like, thank you. Oh, my God. No, but just out of curiosity, did you guys ever go crazy and just suddenly interact with what's going on? Like, did you, like, not even one single, no. Goofy, Toofy, pick up your pants?
No. We were like, no way, we're not doing it.
Sucky, lucky, go blow a joint.
I mean,
do you guys have a personal favorite, like, person that they meet?
Oh.
He knows exactly. James knows exactly.
Okay. Bobby Wobbly. Only because Carrie Elwes, I have to say I disagree with your assessment that he feels like he's selling out as an actor.
He was embracing it. He was like full he on. Was.
He did not give a butt's ass. No. He was just going at it.
He was like all into it.
He's having way too much fun with this role as a guy who just likes bubbles.
I like to wobble around. I can't stop wobbling. Do you like bubbles?
I don't know.
That's the point of the film. I laughed my ass off throughout the rest of the film. I was like laughing my ass off. I cannot stop laughing.
I don't know. Like,
because we have... Because think about it. Before that...
Sympathy. Like, what kind of human being would ever go so low and do that?
Someone who says, as you wish...
By the way, I just need to mention, I actually decided to do like a little like check out the trivia facts and stuff like that. I actually discovered, you know who was supposed to be Bobby Wobbly?
Christopher Lloyd.
I told James exactly, like, yeah, this is the role that they originally wanted Christopher Lloyd to play. And I was like, could you imagine Christopher Lloyd doing that?
Do you like bubbles? I always love wobbling. Now going to the left and going to the right.
Oh my God. But the fact that he's in this freaking movie is just mind-blowing.
But Bubbly Wobbly is just the point where I start laughing throughout the rest of the film because the stuff before was like, okay, keep going. Move along. Bobby Wobbly, it was a point where it was just like... I was having a good time. I was like, this guy's hilarious.
I don't know.
He was channeling Jim Carrey through that whole scene.
Yes, Jim Carrey.
I don't know.
Jim Carrey mannerisms in her.
I don't know. I just feel sadness in this guy. He's just like, well, since I'm in here, I know my career is over. Might as well make the most out of it.
So,
and that's what you have to do as an actor.
Yeah, you have to.
I mean, think about it. We before he came on the scene, we were treated to Joni Braxton, the most gorgeous creature in this entire production, the most beautiful voice, singing a song about coughing and what you do when you have a cold.
Yep.
You go, cough. That is a sad waste of talent right
yes,
here.
Yes, it was.
Because you listen to her voice and she's putting her all into it. It's just a terrible song.
No, I'll be honest. I actually prefer Milky Marvin's, actually.
Yeah. Milkman Marvin.
I don't know. There's like a...
Milkshake Marvin.
There's a...
Yeah, because he was like, hey, man.
There's a certain charm.
There's like the 50s style going on.
I don't know why. There's a part of it. I don't know why, if it's just me, but I feel like there's a part of it he's kind of channeling Christopher Walken. I was like, what if, well, not in terms of voice, but like just how he looks and stuff like that. It's like, you're serious. You're gonna come in here and try to take my balloon, which I promised everyone that I'm gonna give them. To drink the milkshake the fastest.
But
it's like a gift from God that I got this balloon, and I want to bless it on the fastest drinker of my milkshakes. And by the way, here is the chef, who is a cow. She makes all the milkshakes. Don't ask how.
Oh, you clever man. That was a good rhyme.
Wow, I didn't... Oh my god, I actually did rhyme.
Thank you, Dr. Seuss.
I wanted to mention...
The actor playing that character, Chaz Palmerenti, I'm glad you mentioned the Walken connection, because he is somewhat of a mafia movie... actor. Mm-hmm, he was in, I'm looking at his career, and it says, you know, analyze this, Usual Suspects, Bronx Tale.
He has that tone.
That's what he probably brought into the role. I mean, I want to mention that, because does milkshakes sound like they stole recipes from Michelangelo from Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles? Like, you got your pickle milkshake, you got your peanut butter, bacon.
Oh yeah. I like my chill pickle warm pepper pill pecker, please.
Ooh, my favorite.
I was like, what kind of milkshake shop is this? Like, what kind of flavors are these?
I actually kind of
am interested to actually go to Milky Marvin's Milkshake Manor, actually, because of that. I was like, I would actually try that out.
Now, see, here's something else. He had he was giving out a chocolate milkshake that was pink. Did anyone else find that a little bit concerning?
But was it
you? Hey, James, you find, you're telling me that after all the crap that you've seen in Oogieloves, the most concerning thing is that Milky Marvin gave out a chocolate milkshake? That's the most concerning thing about the Oogieloves.
Yes.
Is that what you're telling me?
No. The smiles on the balloon balloons. Those are the biggest creep outs.
Okay.
Oh my god. Actually, that reminds me of the stupidest line I've ever heard in the movie. Is that it's similar to what I just said to you. Is like, there's literally like, I think the green one, the one that looks like a turtle, got a balloon. It's just like, the balloon has a face? But that's impossible. Balloons don't have any organs or anything to speak at. It's like, you're saying, you live in a house where you have a comatose pillow, a talking vacuum, and a freaky window lady, and you're saying that it's impossible for a balloon to freaking talk?
Yeah, it kind of doesn't make sense, actually. It does. But yeah, it was like, I love science. I dedicate anything to science, and I have a pickle fetish. I love my pickles.
Mm-hmm.
Toofy knows best when he eats pickles.
That's like the stupidest thing, honestly.
Like, really pickles? Like, I mean...
Oh, and one thing we forgot to mention. How'd you guys like the extras? You know, the freaking dollar store puppets.
Oh, yeah, the animals, you mean?
Yeah, like, there's random animals.
Yeah, there's like, yeah.
They couldn't get CGI or anything. They couldn't get any extras. They get freaking little puppets.
Yeah, they're like...
And, like, you see raccoons and the... they're dishwashing.
Yeah, dishwashers,
freaking
yeah.
Marvins. You got, like, construction working beavers. You got sheeps.
Yeah.
And I swear to God, now I understand in The Emperor's New Groove what they mean by demon llama.
Yep.
Because...
llama.
That's the first thing I thought when I saw that llama. It was like, oh, so that's what Pacha meant when he said demon llama.
I'll tell you what they're going for here is they realize, you know what, their lead characters are these things that look like they belong in a McDonald's commercial from the early 90s, but...
That is true, no, they're like Grimace's cousins,
mm-hmm.
in a way.
That's
true. Like, I never thought of that McDonald's connection.
So, you have all this weird stuff going on. They're not going to use CGI for the background animals, because, you know... Our lead characters are puppets, so why not just use puppets?
Which functions, I think.
The mouths
barely move, and like there are some cases I think that they had to use CGI in order to make a move.
Yeah, the mouths choose whether or not they want to move, which is so weird.
Mm-hmm.
And when they're sucking on the milkshakes, one of them looked like they were having a seizure because their eyes were going like...
Yes.
They never blink, too. They never blink once. They never.
Yeah.
But the only person...
No, like... they had to CGI that for the fish.
Yes.
Whenever the fish stays stable...
The fish blinks.
Like, when the fish is like, he doesn't move, like he has to have CGI eyes in order to blink.
Yes, I was like, why is the fish blinking but the other freaking characters don't blink? What kind of logic is that?
So, the only thing weird about their choice of background animals is that it just seems so, they all just seem so random, so thrown in. It's like, okay. What's this in the background here? Looking around the flowers there? Okay, why not? You know? It doesn't really serve a purpose to establish that they're even there.
Or no, but I think the worst case is probably the sheep. Like, when you enter the airport, you see the sheep, like, they are holding the glow sticks. It's like, at first I thought, what the heck was that? And then the musical number came, it was like, oh... They're sheep. Okay.
No, you just can't compete with Shaun the Sheep.
Oh, so... Like I said, I broke down when Bobbly Wobbly came down. I broke down completely. I was laughing my ass off. And then when Christopher Lloyd came up, I was speechless. I was laughing too. I was like, what the fuck's going on? Like, there's a flying sub-burro... but it's
Christopher Lloyd lives in a freaking flying sombrero.
Jamie Presley.
I was gonna say that. Jamie Presley is the whitest chick you know, and she's playing a Latino.
That's true. Yeah.
It's like, why are you playing a Latino? Couldn't you cast a Latino actress? And of course, Christopher Lloyd plays a Latino, and it's like, oh, you sure he's tanned a little bit? Sure that I can.
Do you notice in the background he actually has like a poster of this mariachi band, all with pictures of his freaking face?
You're.
Did you notice that?
No, we're gonna have to watch the movie again.
Are you kidding me? We have to watch that for that reference. Oh my god, no! Come on. Didn't notice that.
No, but like, Do you have a feeling maybe they have some kind of weird relationship or something? Because there's this one instance where the girl, like, they assign the fish to do something. And, like, the fish gave, like, gave the fish a kiss. And then suddenly you just see Christopher Lloyd on the side just like... It's just like... It's like, I was confused. It's like, okay, are you some kind of sugar daddy to her?
They must
like,
be married because they have the same last name, so crank.
I know.
Idea.
They're married. I mean, that's what I thought of. They were married.
She's...
she looks pretty young
for... She's, what, 40 years younger?
Does age matter when it comes to love? Are you... really criticizing the age between two
when it's decades.
It doesn't
maybe it's his daughter, you know.
Maybe.
Oh, it could be.
That could be the logical explanation.
But
with what's going on in there, I don't know.
But I don't know anymore. The funniest thing was Christopher Lloyd dancing and then sped up like shit. It was like it's all sped up like what the fuck's going on?
Yeah, oh my god, oh yeah, that's true. Like sometimes they had to speed things up and stuff like that.
It's fan service because that's how you move the sombrero, you dance, and I'm like, what, you dance to make the sombrero go?
Although we can all agree, this is not the weirdest movements we've seen from Christopher Lloyd.
Remember the time when he had to speak with Leonard.
You know that they both came out the same year, you know that?
Yeah, in 2012. Yeah. It's like, what the fridge happened, Christopher? Like, he must have fired his freaking agent for that.
So, on Rotten Tomatoes, it's at, let me see here, it's currently at 27% rotten. It's not at zero, but it's 27%.
Rotten Tomatoes, no, you know the stupidest thing? You know what's the stupidest thing? If you go on IMDb...
Yes, James told me this.
You go on IMDb...
And it has like a 7...
It has 7.4.
4 out of 10.
This is why I...
Yeah, IMDb is, you don't know, because...
This is why IMDb... is the worst place you can go to find, like, ratings and reviews and stuff like that.
Yes.
I swear to God, like, and I visited the message boards at one point. Literally, never have I seen a place filled with the dumbest moviegoers I have ever seen.
So...
like, I lost all respect to IMDb.
So in order for it to get 27% rotten, there were 6 fresh reviews of it. And 9 rotten.
Who gave it fresh reviews?
You want me to read them to you? Here, I'll read them to you.
Freaking who?
All right, this is the first one I like. Laura Clifford from Reeling Reviews says, "The Oogieloves play a lot like Teletubbies in Pee-wee's Playhouse, and it looks like to become a staple in many a small child's DVD collection, and possibly, this is the catch, a cult item in college dorm rooms." That's my favorite fresh one. It's like, oh, so college kids are gonna watch this in the dorms. Like, hey man, let's go watch Oogieloves, man. We'll play a drinking game out of it, man.
What?
Let's see.
The fridge.
Let's see.
What is she thinking? Now, I am I understand about respecting other people's opinions, and I understand we all have different opinions. Yeah. This woman, she must quit reviewing. She must quit now.
It gets better.
That's the stupidest thing I ever heard.
Abby West of Entertainment Weekly. Listen, there are no villains in this movie, but there's a lot of suspense and problem solving involved in retrieving the bones.
Suspense! I'm sorry. Suspense!
That's what she said.
A lot of suspense. Yeah, because, oh god, this is so edge of your seat to find these weird things trying to get a freaking balloon for their pillow! for godforsaken, their Lord and Savior Pillow Christ. They gotta get him. They gotta get the balloon for him. This is so suspenseful. Of freaking course.
Sarah Maria of Box Office Magazine says there's potential to this picture, even if the initial box office reaction was, well...
There's potential. Okay. You saw the movie, right? What potential?
Nancy of Daily Morning News says, if you have preschoolers or fond memories of Todd smiling at friendly costume characters, you might find a soft spot for the gentle film.
Yeah, I'm sure any kid who has a soft spot for Teletubbies or Barney is gonna get another spot for freaking Oogieloves.
So there's some Rotten reviews that are hilarious as well. So there's Jim Judy from Screen, and it says, I keep hearing someone mutter, "The horror, the horror," as 90-minute drink on for what it seems like eternity, and then I realize those words are coming from me.
Your face, man.
Oh, that's gonna be the title card.
Wait, I can't see it. I can't see it.
Got it.
Do I have to sign? Oh, I gotta sign in by Skype. Hold on a sec.
Are you serious? You're not even... Are you not signing to Skype?
I am signed into Skype. That's why we're doing this.
So how are you not seeing the chat?
Really, James? You had to save that, James. Had to save that. I think I gotta save that myself. Oh my god.
Nice. I like you, James.
It's a mess. Well, you were holding that face for so long, I thought you might like it if it just stayed that way.
Although, to be fair, this is the most jaw-dropped I've ever been by someone who was so freaking stupid when it comes to talking about a movie.
Run review. If only there was something on screen to keep your adult brain from dissolving into stream peas. That's what happened. It turned into stream peas.
Yep, that's what happened. Oh, that's what happened.
Oh, God. Oh, my God. Okay, so, yes, we're not the target audience for this film, but, it's just...
Okay, if I may say something.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to make a children's show, and you want to make, like, if you want to make a chill, like, if you want to do anything, this is not just for children's programming. If you want to make a children's show, or you want to make a Saturday morning cartoon, or if you want to make something, like, for TV that's made more for laughs, or something like that, more than it is, like, if you want to do something that's more for laughs and for goofy scenarios, more than it is for original and engaging storytelling, make a freaking children's show or Saturday morning cartoons. Do not waste time making a movie out of it.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
That's the thing. If you're going to make a movie, people are going to treat it like a movie. And as a movie, this is one of the worst films I've ever seen, period. It's just beyond stupid. It's beyond crazy. And that's the thing. It never works if you're trying to make something else. I was like, because, like, this is not, like I said, this is not just for Oogieloves. This is for, like, other movies that I've seen. Like, people try to tell me, oh, this is not... Like, don't try to think of it as a movie. Think of it like a cartoon show where it's more for the laughs and stuff. It's like, yeah, but that's the thing. This is not a cartoon show. This is a movie. This is a movie. And as a movie, it's terrible. No matter what dumb excuse you have to give it. That's the thing. The creators, the directors, or whatever, they're stupid enough to try to execute it because it doesn't work, period. Make a children's show. I'm sure Oogieloves, maybe it would have worked as a children's show. Well, not as a freaking movie.
The catch is that it's based, loosely based on a show that came out 10 years ago called My Bed Bugs. So there was a thing. If you want to do a reboot of it, sure. Yeah, do it for television, but not for film. I mean, the producer of this film was watching Medea Goes to Jail, and he notices the audience was yelling at the screen to tell him to do stuff.
Yeah, for Medea, for freaking Medea. Are you serious?
You get this idea watching Medea.
But you got a children's show. And you were inspired by a freaking Medea thing? Oh my god. Could you imagine if in Medea they have the Oogieloves style interaction? It's like, now when Medea gets herself in trouble, everyone says, girl!
I mean, that's where he got the inspiration from. I mean, he's just like...
And whenever she brings out her sass, you say... Oh, no, she didn't.
Oh, my God.
I'm checking out My Bed Bugs. Oh, my. Yeah.
Yeah.
I can see the similarities. Yes. They actually have J. Edgar.
Yeah.
They have the pillow.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. I think I can see the window, the windy window. She's there, but she's not like this freaky human face. She's literally a window.
Yeah, so it's loosely based on the current, thing that came out in 2004. It was a short-lived series. It didn't last very long. It just, oh, wait, how are we going to make this movie? What TV show could we just steal everything
from? Oh, my God, but I got to admit, they look freakier.
Yeah.
They look a lot more freakier.
Yeah, if you watch My Bed Bugs, look it up. There's a clip out there somewhere. And, yeah, that's the inspiration. That's it's loosely based on that. They took the characters from that. It's just okay.
It would have made a little more sense if they were bed bugs because what the fridge is an Oogieloves?
Yeah, they couldn't just say the bed bugs, my bed bugs, the big balloon adventure. I mean,
yeah,
it would have. Because that would make more sense, really. It's like...
would have made a little more sense.
What were they smoking when they thought of Oogieloves? It's like... what kind of... It's like... Hey, man. That's... screw my bed bugs. Call it, Oogie. Okay, Oogie. And people are going to love this. Yes, Oogieloves. They call it the Oogieloves. That'd be great. Oh my god. God. Yeah, so now you know how we feel. We watched this film. You know everything about it. You don't need to watch it. You don't. If you have children who are young, they might like it. Might is the key word. It's intended for children. It stays for children. Alright? Oh, unless you're college students, too, if you want to have that in your dorm room. Sure, go ahead. Have fun with it. Make sure you're drugged.
I just texted your image to Morgan.
Yeah, really?
He says, I want in to know what's going on.
Oh, I'm sure. I'm sure.
Oh, boy, yeah.
Oh my god, okay. I'm already loving what's going on.
So, I wanted to mention briefly that there is a new film that came out this year from Christopher Lloyd. He starred in. He actually is a villain again in the movie called 88. If you get this connection here, come on. 2015, 88, it's kind of a reference to Back to the Future, Part 2, come on. So, yes, he comes back... playing the mobster role that he was kind of in Street Hawk. And actually, I just discovered when the sucker was released, it's already out. It's not in theaters. It's straight to home video. You guys can go to your Walmart and pick it up on Blu-ray. Go on Amazon, buy it on Blu-ray DVD. It's not in theaters. It's already out. So if you want to check out Christopher Lloyd being a badass in 88, go buy it.
Fairly well.
So this concludes our Christopher Lloyd episode.
Oh, and one more thing I want to mention. While you're at it, while you go watch 88, I also want to recommend you go check out this fake trailer. This is unfortunately not really a movie, called Gobstopper, where Christopher Lloyd plays a horror version of Willy Wonka, and it's really, really good, and it really, really sucks the fact that this is not a real movie. Like, I was actually disappointed.
From the people behind funnierdie.com. All right, so so the next episode is another aging legendary actor. He's like, you know, he's a gentleman, older gentleman, like Christopher Lloyd. He's been...
Christopher Lee, maybe?
No, that would have been kind of nice, fine. Yeah. But
would have been a really nice segue.
Christopher.
From Lloyd to Lee.
Christopher to Christopher. Yeah.
From Lloyd to Lee.
His actor's 74 years old, so he's been in quite a bit of films since 1962. He's been in the business for a while. Lord of the Rings action from 1978. He was an Alien. He was in Heaven's Gate.
John Hurt.
Oh, John Hurt!
We're gonna talk about...
And so off they went on their adventure to watch John Hurt movies for the next Cinema Royale.
So until next time, everyone, we shall be going and exploring this gentleman, who was of course one of the doctors, to see what he has done in feature films.
So yes, tune in next time when we talk about John Hurt, the legendary actor. And I'll pick up that phone call, thank you very much. Hello, Cinema Royale.
Alright.
Paul, we want you to do a better ad than what you did. What? Can you start over?
That's it.
How did Gilbert Gottfried get on my phone?
I honestly don't know. But if you need Gilbert Gottfried, that's gonna be a little bit later. Right now, I'm a little too busy with Celebrity Apprentice, which for some reason I'm in. Yeah, ooh. Yeah, of course, who knew? I'm also a businessman.
Yeah, they assume I was a celebrity, so they got me on here.
Well, it's not... Well, so far, it's not like I'm doing anything, and Disney is not doing anything with Iago, so might as well spend some time with other celebrities for Celebrity Apprentice.
You know, I never got the chance to actually do a Gilbert Gottfried impression, so at least this gave me a moment.
That is all.
You're welcome.
That is all from Cinema Royale. We'll see you next time. Goodbye.
And until next time, I would like to say see you later.
Ciao for now. Life is like a hurricane here in Duckburg. Wind scars, lasers, aeroplanes. It's a duck blur. Might solve a mystery or rewrite history. DuckTales, woo! Every day they're out there making DuckTales, woo! Tales of daring, do bad, and good luck tales, woo! When it seems they're heading for the final curtain, Goldie Duck, she never fails, that's for certain. The worst of men.